lovely people. Well, we are getting closer to the end. And now I'm going to invite all of the speakers who've been here over the past 2 days, and you can ask them all the questions that you like. Also, things that weren't really talked about during these 2 days, if there are any other burning questions that you really would like to ask about. So let's bring up Ole Damgaard. Judith Very Baker. Ken O'Keefe. Mark Devlin. Johan Aldenkamp. Lorna Vitus. And Frank Rasmussen. We also want to say thank you to Louise Sutton, by the way. She's not forgotten.
Am I on? Yes, I am on. Yeah. Welcome to the panel debate. I hope I don't have to say a lot. Of course, if you think I can answer some questions, especially about chemtrails and geoengineering, you are welcome to ask me. And if you have questions about arranging conference like that, what to do, practical matters, I'm also the guy. But it's our great guests here who are in the spotlight. So I just think we should get started. So any questions?
Yes, I have a small question for you, Judith. What do you think about cannabis curing cancer? What
is that? Cannabis curing cancer.
All right, is this me? It's not on.
Oh, it will be.
No. Okay, on now. All right, at the risk of dangers, go for it.
Yeah.
This is kind of a question for the audience also. If there is a full circle group here in Copenhagen, I would very much like to join. And if there is not, could we make one? Me too. You can get my email. Anybody else can come to me or whatever.
Louise Sutton, is there anything to that that you would like to, because you coordinate these events?
Thank you. Well, if there isn't one, and I can't say I've checked, but let's do it before you leave. If there isn't one, it's up to you to start one. Great. So we can certainly do that, but you'll find, hooray, some success. You'll find lots of information and resources on the site, and you'll also find a way to contact me directly. So do that straight away, and the same goes for everyone, everywhere, because we need as many circles or as many groups or gatherings. It doesn't matter if it's not a circle. You can meet around a square or a table, but the principle's the same. Just go and do it. Thank you.
The man, but we are a whole group behind Open Mind Conference where we also try to gather people, and I must give my full support for this Full Circle project. I find it genius, and we will also support in any way on Facebook and Twitter, and even if you have some videos we can link up to our YouTube channel. We will really support it, because this we need to organize, and we need to be smart, and so perfect.
Yeah, my name is Ole Lokman, and I am very grateful that I've been here to the conference, and I would like to say thank you to all of the big speeches that have been here, and I have learned a lot about things I didn't know. I have a request or a question, because there have been laughing a little bit in this conference about flat earth, and we smile a little and say, okay, come on. So, to the panel and to all the audience, I have a request. And because I have been looking this up for only half a year, and actually I don't know anything else but what I have been searching myself and seen on the internet and things like that, but I found some things that I really, really wonder about. And the one thing that I'm wondering about is, and maybe you can help me then, is about finding a photo of the planet that we stay on right now. I just need an image that is not a composite, that is not computerized, that is not stick together by a lot of images, but from one, what about it is it 20,000 satellites, the ISS space station, probably someone said we have been all the way to Mars and things like that, and moon landings. So what I would like is, if you would go home and look in your own local library, in your own bookcase, or go to Google and try to find a real image of the planet Earth, and mail it to me, Ole Lockman. That's my name. Krølle Alpha, what's it called? gmail.com. So that's a request.
Yeah, before, definitely, Johan, you will get this. But I'm actually interested in how many here are interested in the flat earth theory. Raise your hands, be honest. Okay, it's a minority. Anyway, okay, interesting. Johan, I think you are the right man for this question.
I have a television show. I broadcast every week 2 hours. If you go to my website, pateo.nl, and then you go to Pateo TV and go to episode 13, there I give an answer of about half an hour explaining everything about the so-called flat earth theory. I give now a short answer. You can fly from Chile, Santiago in Chile, to Sydney in Australia. According to the flat earth theory, that is 3,200 kilometers. You can fly in 12 and a half hour. Oh, you've been there. Okay, that's one answer. the other one, the problem with the flat earth loonies, if I can call them like that, they are not open for real facts. They are so into the conspiracy that they're not thinking straight anymore, and it makes the discussion a little bit different. Just put the facts on the table, and then it becomes clear. For instance, the Coriolis effect, or it's only happening, or the twist of the how do you call it, the spiral or whatever, is different, and it the different stars at the equator. So it's, there are many things that prove that it is actually a sphere. At least it's called effects are pointing in that direction. And the reason why NASA cannot give a picture of our home planet is that they are not able to go outside of the magnetic field around our planet in order to take a picture. So that's why they have to make composite pictures, because they bluff that they are outside, but they've never been outside. Everything that happens from NASA is about 500 kilometers or less. And that's why they keep up a big myth that they have been further, but you cannot go around the planet because of the Van Allen belts. The radiation is so powerful that it kills all biological life. Thank you.
Okay, we have a question on this side.
1, 2, 3. It's not that much of a question as a response, and I like to do Max Egan's words, mine, at the moment. Whether the world is flat or round, it doesn't really matter compared to the danger we are about right now. The globe or the flat earth is being poisoned, and that's maybe more important than whether it is flat or round. Thank you.
Yep.
Sorry. Stand up. There are two ways to look at, or many ways, to look at the problem we are having. And the one is human beings having a special kind of disturbed consciousness. And the other is that we are, all of us, giving our life to a certain paradigm or a way of using our own being. And I think if the problem is as big as it seems, which is getting worse every day, somehow we are all in on it. I think we are all programmed to, or have programmed or allowed ourselves or are born into this path we are on, because else it wouldn't be happening. So I just thought that we might look into the structures of that being that we are becoming. And we are looking at ancient programs, because we say we are the same people, but I don't know if they have been eating GMOs and synthetic herbs or whatever they're putting in our foods. Yeah. Or anything of what we are doing.
Sorry, what is the question? Because we have limited time.
Okay.
So we need a question.
Yeah.
You have a question?
Yeah, if I'm you think I'm was tired, then I don't want to talk.
No, it's nothing about that. It's simply that most probably we have a lot of questions and we have limited time, so that's the reason.
Okay, we have a question over here. Yeah,
stand up. Hi, I'm Joe from the UK, England, which is and I've got a question for Oddie. So with the false flag attacks that have happened more recently, the Charleston and Virginia lone gunman shootings, Virginia. Anyway, just wondered what your take on that was and whether it's to actually assess how dumb, I suppose, people have now got. So especially the Virginia shooting, where they took the story right out of the media very, very quickly. There was nothing kind of to follow up. The actors, you know, were particularly bad, and I think I asked you a question maybe in June, possibly in Amsterdam, the same kind of thing, and you responded to say that it's just they are just making silly mistakes in the process of these false flag attacks. And I just wondered if you've changed your mind or what you think.
I think we're at a point where. With many of these operations, there's more than one reason. And one is the standard false flag, scare the living bejesus out of people. The people that are not aware enough will get the message and be scared like they want. And then making it so obvious that it's so bad is for the rest of us to show our face so that they can map the resistance. So they totally have checked on Facebook and these other sites what people are commenting, who's sharing all of these things. So it's just a matter of being aware of that and then do what you want to do anyway. So I think that is why they do it so bad. I mean, it's like I get tears in my eyes. I get very tired at times. And I believe that is the reason.
Yeah. I mean, the acting is just so poor. You know, just think, how can they get these people?
No, but it's like, if you noticed, in the old days, when there was a competition or something like that, they put out questions, and these were questions that needed some kind of brain activity to answer. Nowadays, you have like, win a mobile phone, and you have to answer the following question. It will cost you 35 cents. What is 1 plus 3? Why do they do that? They do it to engage as many as possible from the age of 2.5 and upwards to get the 35 cents and also get their email addresses and so on, so they can bombard these poor buggers. Whatever it is, here it is, let's make it so bad that even the ones that are, I think something is going on, we get them as well.
Thank you for your answer.
That is my take on it. Or otherwise, they're so bad at what they're doing. At least, I mean, keep the same color shirt on, the same color of skin. These type of things, use a real gun, at least with blanks, so you got like, I mean, come on, guys. Or chop the head of someone, then chop the head, or at least have a head there somewhere in the neighborhood. You know, at least look freaked out when you're in the background. At least look at the victims. We're talking about Lee Rigby. I mean, these type of things. It's good to at least make it credible, let the police arrive maybe within 1 minute, 2 minutes, 25, it's a bit awkward.
Maybe you can get a job with them.
I know. Thank you. I'm broke. Come on, hire me. So, no, my point.
Beautiful.
Great. We have another question here.
Please stand up. Yeah. Hi, I have a question. I'd like to hear your opinion about the hoax I've seen a lot of time in the. Yes. On the internet, they talk a lot about. In the future, there might be an alien attack. And what is your opinion about the? It's a hoax, I think. And the one world government is going to save us with a new war.
I'm sorry. Who would you like to ask? Does anybody want to answer this? Everybody said no, no.
Okay. Aliens or not aliens, fear is the agenda. I have no idea if they're gray, tall, small, green, or whatever. If they're not, doesn't matter. When they have this whole agenda, it's to freak people out. Problem, reaction, solution. A bearded Muslim called Abdul Karim Karumkar or a green alien, doesn't matter. Freak the people out and they will buy it. They tried in the old days, it was Russians, Bulgarians, East Germans. Before that, it was the Japanese during the Second World War. Then the wall came down. What are we going to do? What are we going to do? In came Reagan. The aliens are here. Okay, no, it didn't really work. So who, Muslims. Then they went into the Scandinavian ones. And soon, we will see the terror grandma. We will see grandparents with bombs in their wheelchairs because they're running out of options. So.
Hi, Johan. Hi, over here. I want to ask you about the polar magnetic polar shifts. Do you think we are a middle in a polar shift right now? And I have read about it. The magnetic fields are weak, and sometimes I think, can it has something to do with the chemtrails? Did you understand my questions? I'm a little nervous, a lot.
Yeah, I'm just wondering why you think that I am the expert on this subject, because there's something going on with the magnetic field, that's clear. And yes. Especially on the southern hemisphere, the navigation is completely off. So, and it's known that the magnetic field is flipping in a certain cycle. So I think it's about time that we see that flip. And before that flip, there are a lot of anomalies. So that makes sense.
So when you say the south magnetic field, you mean the one at north, geographic north? Yes.
But it's just to make us really
that's
make
the right
brain
thing to say, yeah. Because that's right.
Yeah, that's true. The magnetic truth. North is actually the South Pole, and yes. The magnetic South is the North Pole. Yes. But this is only to confuse people. just like the electric pole, plus pole is actually the minus. But that's all details. Just it's a definition question. Mm-hmm. But I think that magnetic flip will change, will affect us. Some people also talk about a physical flip of the planet, but I don't think that ever happened, so I don't go into that. But you, at the moment, you cannot tell which is a natural phenomenon and which is artificial, because actually they are doing so many things that it's, we look at the weather, I'm not sure if it's here, but in my own country, it gets completely crazy, and the weather, people on the television try to look as if normal, and they keep on doing the same broadcast every day again. But if you look at the long run, it's, yeah, I don't think you can say anything sensible anymore. So they are certainly doing things, but what the big agenda is, I have not figured it out yet.
Because the magnetic field is very weak, so we get a lot of sun
radiation, no, radiation from,
yes,
cosmic, yes.
So sometimes, are they actually taking a little bit care of something on the Earth, maybe the plants, or I don't know. I just have to take both sides before I see. I know that's naive, maybe.
Yeah, but I think it's good.
Vice versa, take.
I personally have trust in the big plan, so I think there's more cosmic radiation coming, but maybe some parts of our DNA is activated by that, and maybe it's just meant for a transformation process. I don't know. Fear is never a good guidance for me, so I don't allow myself to be afraid of anything.
No. I'm not afraid. Yeah. I'm not afraid.
I just wanted to say, don't be too afraid of the magnetic field's weakness. I mean, we have the problems, yes, with more radiation and so on. Notice that the birds are losing their ability to navigate because they have it right in their brains how to get here and there through using the magnetic north, which is getting weaker and weaker. And it's also moving erratically. The airports have had to change their north south orientation to the new orientation so that when they're flying a lot of miles, they don't go off course like birds do now. And a number of incidents, but about the magnetic field flipping suddenly, geologic evidence shows us the flip, yes, is very, very fast in geologic terms, but it's actually isn't going to happen instantly, because otherwise we wouldn't have it stuck in the, we have layers where it was once south and now it's north and then south and then north. That takes time for those molecules to line up and be, made to be solid demonstrations of these various layers. That takes time, and you can measure it. It's not going to happen like day after tomorrow and then all of a sudden our brains are scrambled. It's more like 60, 70 years it'll take to make the flip, or maybe 100 like that. So we were to have time, we should have to adjust, otherwise life would have a real problem. You have left and right, for example, proteins, and a lot of our body is magnetically influenced, and we'll have time to adapt to that. It's not that scary that way. What is interesting is the Earth is slowing down a little, and it's wobbling, and I'm always wondering, you know how a top, if he slows down, we have slowed down, and they keep having to add milliseconds, you know, to the rotational. I'm wondering, sometimes I do wonder what it takes to make it wobble enough to actually go into a, right now we're at a certain angle. It hasn't always been at that angle. Also, you know, the moon is moving further away from the Earth at all times, and it'll take a long, long time to do it, but eventually we will not have the electromagnetic field at all that's helped be generated by the moon.
Great. So we have a few questions. I'm going to go, because I see lots of raised hands. So go one, two. I don't know who came first, so I'm just going to go three, four, five. Yep. Six.
Right. Stand up and speak to that.
This is a question for you, Johan. Yahweh, is he a lunar deity? And is Yahweh and Allah the same deity?
Somebody else was talking about Yahweh. Who was that? I'm not sure. I thought somebody did here, but in my opinion, Yahweh is the same as El. And El is actually Saturn. And when you look at the name Israel, it means leading to El, or leading to Saturn. And Bab El means the gate to El. And in the Bible it's called, in ancient Akkadian language, is Bab Ilu. And Ilu and El, they're all ancient names for Saturn. And there is a really big group on this planet, they all worship Saturn as the highest deity. Yeah, that's the Saturn death cult, or how you like to call them. And that's pure Saturnism. So, and even some people say Satan and Saturn is actually the same. But I've not figured out why a planet with rings, the Lord of the Rings in the Book of Tolkien, is so important. It's of course, but every planet has effects. But it was called in ancient Greek the timekeeper, because it's the slowest planet going round. And maybe people who worship Saturn think that they are also controlling time. That's what I can imagine. But again, it's of course every planet is an entity, is a conscious being, so to say. And maybe the story is much bigger than this. But I choose to honor the light, the light bringer, Jesus, or I call it Helios. That to me is important. And the lights also come from the stars. So I choose the light and not the darkness. I choose the sun over Saturn. That's my personal take on this. And but I'm not afraid of the darkness or of any entity, because they're afraid of the light. It's the other way around. We shouldn't be afraid of them. They are extremely afraid of us, because we have something they cannot get their mind around. We have a capacity, a unique capacity of becoming light. And I think that's why we are such beautiful, or we can be such beautiful creatures. And I think we should cherish that. So I think we should not give too much attention to all the darkness and the negativity, because that's taking away our energy of spending it on the light. So that's how I take it. Yeah.
Yeah. Hi. I want to ask a question to Ken or Kiev. We have today all these horrible stories and what we see at our borders about the refugees. And I know it's all over Europe now, and it's creating a lot of problems. And you know, everybody knows. So, what is your take? I know why. Obviously, it's because of war and everything. We know that. But do you have other meanings about this, Ken?
Well, the good... When you're facing an overwhelming enemy who has all the resources at their beck and call, you can't stop them from carrying out their aggressive agenda. What you can do, though, is use their momentum against them. They provide a lot of opportunities. It's the classic standing on the edge of the cliff with a red cape in front of the bull. Go on, charge. You know, take the cape away and let the bull run off the side of the cliff, because it's obviously part of an agenda. The first thing to say about the refugee thing is, first off, it pisses me off, and we should be pissed off that they call them migrants. That's just wrong to begin with. We are ISIS. That's the bottom line. We are ISIS. We are Al Qaeda. We are the ones that fund that through our proxies in Saudi Arabia. If we're serious about reducing the refugees, then we need to get our so-called governments, our so-called public servants, to stop funding and arming the terrorist nations that are the prime financiers for these head-chopping psychopaths in the Middle East. It's our best friends, our medieval Wahhabi Salafi buddies over there in Saudi Arabia. Who's our two primary allies in the region? This medieval monstrosity known as Saudi Arabia, which is just, we care about women, don't we? Oh yeah, we love women, we love the Afghani women, we love all that, don't we? Yeah, look at Saudi Arabia. That's our best friend and ally. The last military contract with Saudi Arabia, $60 billion with the United States. The UK is not far behind in providing them weapons as well. So we're not solving any problems as long as that stays in play. If that, you know, so why kid yourself? And so now let's deal with the reality of the refugees, since we haven't cut off the funding and continue to provide political cover for our best friends and allies, who are the financiers for all this mayhem. So now that we have the problem, because we haven't addressed the root of it, what do we do? Well, clearly we have an obligation to these people. That's obvious. I mean, we're the ones that have destroyed their countries, you know, continents even. And so therefore we have a responsibility to them. However, we have to be completely aware of the fact that this is all by design. And of course, while these refugees come in and we're all being bleeding heart, liberal, lefty, you know, humanitarians and whatnot, trust me, they're bringing these people in to pit us against each other, because a prerequisite for a tiny minority maintaining control is to pit the people against each other. And boy, oh boy, is that going to work out real well when all these refugees come in. And already you have domestic populations who are a little pissed off about the whole thing, even before all this. They're going to get more pissed off. It's going to make more people agitated. And of course, they'll have agents carry out a false flag, and then they'll get more agitation. All of this is so predictable. So the best thing that can be done is to be aware. That's number one. Be aware.
Great. So the question here is number three. Yep. Stand up.
Hello. I just want to ask, all the false flag things that are happening, and, you know, the emergency services are there, and I work in the medical industry, or the medical world, and I just can't believe that somebody like me would not report that something was real when it was false. You know, when you find it, you read in the news, you know, everything's, this has been bombed and that's been bombed, and you know it was an exercise. Where are these people? How are they controlled? You know, why don't they come forward like I would come forward? You know, if something happened, I was instructed to do something and I knew it was wrong, it was false, I would come out and speak about it. How are these people controlled? How do we never hear these people?
Okay, I would like to quote Chip Tatum. I talked about him before. He's a CIA whistleblower, 25-year deep cover agent, black op assassin, one of Night Stalker pilot. He was the commander of Pegasus, an ultra-secret hit team under the direct control of George Bush Sr., taking out at least 17 people in Europe. Not an amateur. He has been involved in quite a few false flags. I asked him the exact same question. How do you control a group like that? He was the one that really gave me a lot of detailed information about why they need to keep it in such a small group as possible, why they use the same awful actors. The reason for the awful actors is because the good ones are known. You know, they have done jobs, so they would be recognized. So you need to get total amateurs that are known and do an awful job, including duping delight when they smile all the time. So what he said, I said, but how do you keep them quiet? Why are they not stepping forward? He said, very easy. Number one, money. You just shut people up by money. They have unlimited funds. He said, most of the time he was walking around with like $50,000 in his pocket for just occasion. There's a police officer coming. Okay, here you go, 30,000, bugger off. Or at the airports, I don't know if you noticed, Ben, but when American airplanes land, the big one, military planes, very often the amount of drugs in that city, Belfast, wherever, Dublin, boom, goes up. Could it be combined? Could it be connected somehow? According to Chip, yeah. Anyway, but so he was constantly having loads of money to pay people off if needed. So he said, in these groups, first you try pay them, and most people are bought off. Then, if that doesn't work, very easy, you kill their dog, their child, their grandmother, or some, and you let it be very obvious to the rest of the group that this is what happens. You shut up, or if that is enough, if people still think I'm going to become a whistleblower because it's really worth it, then you kill them. Very easy. It's without emotion. These people, it's taking care of business, nothing personal. Sorry, I'm just going to chop you to pieces to make a statement. So I tell you, whatever, who's ever listening to this that think, oh my God, it's such a great idea to sign up as a crisis actor, you are getting yourself into deep shark waters. You will be paid a small fee. I would say, get out. Do not even consider it. And if I can just continue, there's a radio host in the States called Chris Geo, who called in to the crisisactors.org, you can go there, sign up yourself, and recorded the whole thing. I loved it. He phoned up And he talked to this woman who was the woman, the recruiter, and she said, "Oh, that's great that you call in. Thank you so much. We're looking for a job. We have an upcoming event in Oklahoma City. It's going to be a school." She said, "Have you any background like that? Can you grow a beard and stuff?" He said, "Yeah, I've been working in a university." "Oh, we need a headmaster. It's so good. And you sound good. Yep, yep, yep. And if you can't grow a beard yourself, we can always add that. So that, excellent. So let me get your name and number and I'll sign you up for an appointment with the producer. This is recorded. I have got it. It is wonderful." That's how they do it. It's just ordinary business. I don't understand the people involved, but that's it. And many of them are proud of it. Look at their smiles and their... My father had his head chopped off by ISIS. It is so weird, but I hope that answered your question.
Okay, my name is Kit Larsen-Hughes, and I come from Sweden. And I'm very happy to have been here and listening to you all. And my question is to Lune. You know, it was very informative and the speech you had. But I am really bothered about the geoengineering and what they are spraying at us. You know, the aluminium, barium, strontium. And it also affects our soil, our food. And the aluminium, you know, you were talking about that, and the Alzheimer's and everything. So is there a discussion with about that where you are and the farms and so here in Denmark?
Thank you. Yes, there's certainly a discussion in Denmark, and I think that things are changing this last year, at least. It has been very much the same, but the debates, the writing and talking about it has changed a lot during only the past 9 months, actually. So it does matter to talk about these things, and it does matter to raise the question everywhere it's possible to raise it. Now our government changed in May this year, but before that I think that there was a new kind of access for direct contact. Now things are being worse again, but you can always hope. But among organizations, there's a different way of thinking, because the supermarket, the greatest one in Denmark, or one of the greatest, Coop, has changed their politics because of the people's craving for other kind of food, for organic food. So they changed their policy about price. They lowered the price. They were willing to earn lesser money for the same kind of food, and they broadened the possibilities of shopping organic food, and that made the consumers' demand increase even more. So during this year there has been a great change in this country, at least. It's very positive.
And I might add about your question with all this aluminium. There was a few months ago a new report from university in Canada who have measured 20 hives of bees with aluminium content in the pupae. And it was terrifying reading, because the average aluminium content in the pupae was 58 microgram per microgram organic stuff. And if you compare that with the aluminium content you have in a brain with Alzheimer's, it's 3 microgram. So it's 18 times higher in the bees than it is in the humans who already got affected about it. And considering also the bees' very advanced navigation system, nervous system and everything, I will say that I agree with Luna about that the pesticide is a huge problem, but it's a combination with the nanoparticle pollution from the atmosphere. And actually, glyphosate, which is the active stuff of Roundup, when we eat that, it can bind the metals in your body. That means you become even better antenna for all the Wi-Fi. So it's very difficult for me to see that this is not a conspiracy against the humans.
My name is Wimor. Anybody know anything about sinkholes?
May I ask what concerns you about sinkholes?
I don't want a sinkhole just right here.
Where do you live?
Oh, here in Denmark.
You live on top of a lot of magma and everything else that's not going to develop sinkholes anytime soon, probably. And I lived in Florida for a long time. There you have layers, phosphate-rich, calcium-rich material that's laid down because of ancient coral beds and so on. And what's happening there, we have acid rain coming down. Of course, our rain is often acid in the United States, and also just from pollution runoff, and it when it hits the ground, on top of that, it hits all kinds of organic material, you know, dead grass and all that. All that is acidic, and so it percolates down into the ground, and over periods of thousands of years or all that, forms enormous caverns underground. And finally, then you build a house on top of it, and you've got pipes leaking and other things going on, toilets flushing that might leak, and all of a sudden there's your sinkhole, down goes a house into the hole and all that. Say, what a surprise. Actually, it's not. There are usually warning signs. Often sinkhole forms nearby, and you can see bubbling up surface. When you see those bubbles coming up, those are obviously air-filled caves and everything. They're filling up with water, you know, as they fill up. If the water is percolating somewhere else because of pressure, again, you'll have another sinkhole. So this is a natural phenomenon, but it's been exacerbated by human activity a great deal. And when they do mining, they do salt mining like in Florida and other places and remove the salt, or if they're doing fracking, for example, and they're removing materials and they pump in water underneath, it has nowhere to go except along various fractures, and then you get earthquakes, and we're getting many, many earthquakes that never existed before, and fracking should be outlawed. That's all I'll say that.
My given name is Shantiri Tamparamahansa, and I want to thank Frank and Mess and Carol for this conference. And I want to thank all of you people who are brave enough to be on stage, and especially I want to thank my brother. I want to thank my brother because I've known him for so long, and I know how much courage it has taken for my brother to do his journey and to be where he is today. So with his permission, I would like to add two personal experiences that I find important to his excellent presentation earlier today. Around what happened on Utøya and in Oslo. Do I have your permission, Ole?
Yes.
Okay. So, first of all, in 2011, I went to St. Moritz protesting the Bilderberg meeting there and to do a documentary about this. When I was there, I personally saw and photographed the Norwegian Crown Prince. I think that is the correct expression. And his military bodyguard in a minivan on their way to attend the Bilderberg meeting. It is my absolute belief that he was there to be briefed about what was going to happen later that year in Norway, and that because Kong Olav and the Norwegian royalty played an amazing, a very powerful role in how to control and manipulate the Norwegian population. The second personal experience I had was on the morning, the day after Utøya, when I was watching the Swedish news. And that was a government expert on weapons. His name is Sonny Björk, and he was very, very frequently seen on television around the Palme assassination as a weapons expert. Sonny, on the morning before noon news on Swedish television, made a very remarkable remark. He said about what happened in Oslo, he said, everything appears like if it has been a car bomb. However, there is no crater. How he knew that, in the morning, the day after it happened, I don't know. But it was a remarkable thing for him to say, as far as I'm inside, being an insider. So first of all, the presence of Norwegian royalty just previous to what happened in Norway. And second, this remarkable statement that there was in fact no crater until a week later, something after they shoveled it up. So that was, thank you very much. That was all I want.
Okay.
Thank you. Got one question here first, and then it's you afterwards.
Yeah, hello, and thank you so much to all the speakers for an amazing mind-opening experience this weekend. My name is Troels, and I would like to ask the panel about something that's going on in farming these days, relating to GMO, but also relating to the new area of the microbiota, the living organisms inside of us that's actually extremely important for our metabolism, our ability to get nutrients through our gastrointestinal system, and also apparently having an epigenetic role in how our genetic expression is working. Actually, we are all like shells of their genetic material. 99% of the genetic material in our bodies is actually not our own. It's the genetic material of the microbiota. So my question for you guys is, what have you investigated the connection between Novozymes and Monsanto going into creating GMO bacteria that could eventually infect our own microbiota, thus influencing our genetic process?
You will get it also. You know, I look at this again from chemtrail perspective. If you kill all the organisms in the earth, you need to replace them. And if you can make money out of that, it will be a very good business. So I'm just saying they know what they are doing, and they also know that we are creating this mayhem. We are making food prices increase tremendously, so the poor people will have even more difficult to get food in the future, and this is absolutely just a plan in my view. But Judith, you also had a comment? Or?
Well, I just say something. I don't want to waste anybody's time.
Good. Okay. So, yeah, it's a plan.
Great. So we have another question here, so if you stand up.
Yes. Thank you so much. What a great team you are, everyone. I want to ask about the Fukushima thing. What do you think about the radiation still coming and pouring out into the Pacific? How severe is it, and what can be done? Is there anything that you can neutralize it with in putting it into the environment to take away the radiation that's there and that's coming, still coming? Judith, maybe?
I'd like to tell you that during the Cold War, which many of you may not know happened, that while they were developing various nuclear weapons, And then when they were testing various one, they began building atomic reactors. They had a habit of putting these into barrels, the residue and the spent materials, getting rid of them. What they did, they put them on big barges, and we're talking about thousands of barrels of radioactive material. You're talking about Fukushima. I'm talking about millions of tons of residue over, not just us, but the Soviet Union and so on, Japan, all the various countries, and all along the coastline of the eastern coastline of America, these are starting to burst. And the results are, you know, they're finding contaminated. Now, what are they doing? We have Sweden, who has dug a very deep hole to try and put all this material in, you know, and it's supposed to, you know, be safe for 1,000 years or whatever. But another way they've tried to get rid of the all this waste is they've used depleted. You need to know this, and you probably do. How many of you know what depleted uranium is? And you know where they're, you know, it's extremely heavy. You know, lead is heavy. Depleted uranium is even heavier and denser. Therefore, it's great as a shield to stop bullets from hitting you. So they're making, it's very, very heavy, and they're putting it on all these tanks and everything, and also using it for bullets and shields, you know, in the front of especially big bombs and so on. What's interesting is that the men inside are getting all this radiation. They're running, but they left them all behind in Afghanistan. They've left them behind in Iraq. And our enemies, so-called, have taken them over, and they're sitting in them and shooting at people, you know, in their nice depleted uranium covered vehicles that are going to give them testicular cancer and so on. Yeah. We have babies being born with two heads, you know, and in Iraq. I mean, in Iraq. It's a crime, but we don't know what we're doing with all these waste products. The fact that we still have, in the United States, we have so many nuclear reactors that are in service, I think 99 at least. And a lot of them are aging. Sweden, what, has three, and, you know, we have wind, we have all that. But you know what, when you have control of, I'm going to give you a scenario. Imagine if you can't get into a nuclear reactor facility for just 48 hours. Say that things break down or whatever. Take the personnel out for 48 hours, and a reaction begins because it's not under control anymore, and it builds up. There comes a point of no return. You in just a matter of 3 days, if we had 99 nuclear reactors, it would all blow up. We're not being very careful as it is. I mean, you of course you see on TV the cartoon characters and all that. They're running these nuclear plants. I'm telling you right now, we have very inept control of these. We're going to have other Fukushimas. Yeah.
I have a little bit of different take on this. If you look what happened in Chernobyl and how soon everything was normal there, actually it's above normal. I think my research shows there are no atomic weapons at all. Judith talks about it, but I know it's a hoax.
You're talking about atomic waste.
Yeah, but they make us afraid. I don't think that what happened in Fukushima, of course it was a big accident, but they make it much bigger in order to make us afraid of nuclear energy. I think it's really stupid to not use the technology of Tesla, but atomic energy is not as bad as they want us to think. It's coming from the environmental, how you call them, extremists, and they think it's really bad, but it's not that bad. It's just a stupid way of creating energy, of making electricity because of heating water by actually very inefficient technology. But the main line I want to say is
if you are getting afraid of atomic weapons, atomic radiation, then you are again a victim of fear porn.
Yeah. Okay.
Oh. Having worked with radiation a great deal and having suffered myself radiation damage, it is real. Yes, okay? And I'm not trying to argue with anybody's theory, but also I've been at Los Alamos when I was a little girl and where they had all these things going on. I want to tell you something about radiation. The first thing I did, I had held in my hand, because I didn't know any better, in a lab, a handful of mercury, liquid mercury. We were playing with it in a laboratory. We weren't aware. I remember when we had our feet x-rayed, you could see our bones and wiggling our toes and all that kind of thing. Every bit of x-ray that hits your body, wherever it comes from, we have collected these radioactive elements. Now, he's right about one thing. You know, when a plant blows up, after about 48 hours or so, most of the danger is over. But you all only, if you think Hiroshima and when it hit Nagasaki, if you think that that happened by conventional means, well, you can go ahead and prove it, but Fat Boy and all that, I came from the Chicago area. My father was into technology. We saw a lot that was going on. Nuclear weapons do exist, and you can say they do not, but we have evidence of, again, depleted uranium that is destroying people's lives all over the planet, wherever they've used it. We see, where do you think we get... We have linear accelerators, for example, that are aimed at any object, and you can go and radio and make it radioactive. We have radioactive wastes that are being released, and we pull up fish, you know, with no scales on them. And they've got pink bulbous tumors all over their bodies, and you check them. You know, how many of you? You probably don't help, but how many? Any of you have a? They used to have them all the time. A Geiger counter. They used to have Geiger counters. They're hard to get now, and you know what? They don't really want you to have them. All kinds of things are, if you could see them, they would light up, you know. We have radiation. We have a lot of radiation damage, and I've personally been damaged by radiation. My hands look a lot older than the rest of my body because we didn't know enough to protect our hands properly when I was like irradiating my mice and all that kind of thing with radioactive materials. Please, technology is very advanced, and perhaps you don't think or believe because there's a lot of misinformation, disinformation, and none of you even own a Geiger counter so that you can understand what is even hot in your veggies, in your vegetables and all that. And they're gonna send all these people back into Japan. We had a cleanup over in Japan of various materials. And yes, it all finally goes away. It all finally goes away. But if you think that all that damage you're saying happened just from conventional bombs, I had personal experience with people. It's just like denying that Jews actually died. They say, oh, they all starved. And I had a museum right
I think
next
we
to
have. I think okay. We have covered this. Okay. And I also want to add, I think Kenny mentioned yesterday with Fallujah and all these babies, I think it was raised 400 times or something like that. The incredible amount. Before they had one baby a month, which were born with defects, and now they have one baby a day. And this is depleted uranium. And if you have some toxic waste you cannot get rid of in an atomic energy producing industry, it's very smart. You just sell it to the US Army and they spread it all over the world, and then the pharmaceuticals can earn even more money. So, yeah, again, I must say, I think it stinks.
We've got a lot of questions just to be...
As I said yesterday morning, do not believe a single word I'm saying. I'm saying that again. But please have an open mind. Maybe it's not true what they say about nuclear weapons. Maybe it's not true what they say about the damage of radiation. There is a guy on internet, Galen his name, he worked there, he is eating radioactive material while he's giving the lecture. I'm not sure if it's all correct, but just have an open mind. Don't jump into conclusions. That's what I'm saying.
Okay, great. So we have one question here, and then cheeky me, I've got a question. And then I have the microphone. So, and then I'm going to go over there. There's three over there. Yep.
Yeah, hi, my name is Mads Palsvi. We're talking about false flag operations, and as a banker, there was this incident with China recently where there was this harbor that all of a sudden exploded 2 days after they devalued their renminbi 2% only. But was that a message? I have this question obviously for Ken or Ole, whoever wants to answer that. But since we have the Fukushima thing going on as well, was that some kind of a message to the Japanese for some reason? If you know anything about that, we're very interesting to find out. And then regarding whether nuclear weapons exist or not, there was also the bomb in Yemen 2 months ago, which clearly looked like it was a mushroom shape. It could have been a nuclear bomb or something else. And then if you look back in wars during the history, you always start the war presuming that your opponent has the same weapon as in the last war, and always someone has a surprise for you. And come on, of course the United States have some weapons they haven't shown yet, and the Russians have it as well. They scrambled an American ship in the Black Sea. They just flew over them two flights, and nothing worked on the boat. There was a message to the United States from the Russians. So have you got some views? I'm convinced that there no way Americans show us all the weapons they have. No way the Chinese will do it. No way the Russians will do it. So in bearing that in mind, what do you think about, was this a message, the bombing of the, or no, sorry, it was an explosion, an accident. The accident, which I think might be a bombing, the accident in the Chinese harbor 2 days after the devaluation of the renminbi, and then there was another 3 explosions. What a coincidence, within the next week or so. 4 different accidents, and at the same time, there was one in Moscow River with the oil explosion, remember, actually within a couple of days. Have you got any view on that? Thanks very much.
What I can see is that you have a comment? Okay.
First of all, there is technology that we know. When we look at 9/11, that's a clear case example, because the technology used there is not known. And the story you talk about, the machine ship that was completely, by EMP probably, not able to function anymore. That's remarkable. The name of Mehrankesh was named in some sources. That's an Iranian man who studied nuclear physics in London, and later he developed his own technology. He's now in the south of Italy. And he claims that he also was responsible of the catch of the drone above Iran. Maybe you've heard about that. There's a beautiful video on the internet, you can find it, where 2 Iranian men proudly show it. It's in a sports like this, and they put it on a table with nice flags around it, and they talk about it. And Obama had to officially give a request if they please could send it back, because it has high-tech technology they don't want the Iranians to know. So actually, they took a toy from a child and they put it on the floor, didn't do any damage, and I think they have superior technology. But it's all guesswork for me. But of course, I'm 100% right, I agree with you, they don't show everything to the main public. And the same is true, I think, for space travel. There is much more to tell, but we are kept in the stupid zone, or in the unknown zone.
The first thing that needs to be considered when any kind of significant event, such as a major explosion or something like that, is who would stand to gain. I mean, so that's an obvious question. So like on 9/11, you know, who would stand to gain? You know, is there any existing known agenda that might benefit from this event? You know, these are very simple things to consider. And any serious investigator, if you have a crime scene, of course you'd seal off the crime scene. You would hold all evidence there, analyze it forensically and whatnot. I don't know what the Chinese have done, but, you know, if they've sealed off the scene, they should be able to get very obvious signs if it was some sort of nuclear explosion. I will agree with Johan, particularly with the point of keeping an open mind. It's easier said than done. We can use it as a phrase, but not many people really have open minds when it comes to things that they hold dear. You know, we really resist information that counters our worldview. I was discussing this with you earlier. There was a lot of motivation for sabotage, economic sabotage in China. That's undeniable. So the motive is there. The capacity to do so is there. But like Ole here, Jesus Christ, man, you can just make your entire life revolve around keeping up with all of this shit. I mean, it's just never ending. And, you know, I've seen the pattern. I know the game. You know, okay, so is this the latest soap opera version of the, you know, whatever. But I think there's far more evidence to suggest that this was a deliberate attack with a very specific message. That would be my opinion.
Can I just say, please watch the movie Wag the Dog with
Dustin Hoffman,
Robert De Niro, where they have a president who was given a BJ from some woman. There was this scandal. He even looked like Clinton, sorry about naming. But they needed to avoid the scandal. So they come up and with a war against a nation that doesn't even exist and pump it out through media, persuading the population that we're at war. And they've even just made up a nation. It didn't even exist. So just because it's served to you in this black box in front of you, do not believe it. I live in the south of Spain. At times, people in Sweden call down and say, "How are you? How are you?" I'm like, "I'm fine." "Well, there's an earthquake." I said, "Where?" "Right where you live." I said, I don't know. They called down and said, "How are you?" "I'm fine. How are you?" "No, I mean, how are you?" "I'm good." "Why?" "There's this massive fire." "Where?" "Right where you live." I tell you, they are at times they're playing ping pong with our brains. And if I can just mention also, since I spent thousands of hours in dusty archives and so on before the internet, and so I discovered that many times these newspapers have one edition for the north of the country, one edition for the south, and one maybe for the central of whatever country it is. They do not present the same story in many times, because in the south it will say, "Ooh, this thing happened in the north." In the north, they said, "Ooh, the exact same thing happened in the south." And when you had the Ebola thing, it was in Ghana. Then in Ghana, it was in Peru. In Peru, they were talking about Mexico. In Mexico, they were talking about the U.S. It's like, what is going on? Is it real or is it not? It was, and where did the Ebola go, by the way? I mean, suddenly we were under this massive threat, and apparently we're fine now. Jihad Johnny, oh my God, where did he go? The swine flu, oh my God, where did it go? They're playing ping pong with our brains.
Great.
I have a small suggestion about your question. I follow the economic development, especially with a view of the gold angle, and China and the BRIC countries have accumulated gold like crazy the last 5 years. China is not exporting anything, not even from their mines in Africa and Australia and their own mines, and they are buying up cheap from the central banks in Europe. And I think it could be a warning signal from the US, which have the world reserve currency now, that something happens when China actually moves a little bit with their own currency. Because United States, no, I don't believe United States have a lot of gold. They have been pumping it all out to manipulate the market. And we will soon see an end. I already believe we're now seeing an end of it in silver. Some brokers of silver is talking about 8 weeks delivery time now, and they are not even able to get all the silver they are ordering. They're only getting a fixed portion by the mint, a different kind of mint company. So the United States, who have the reserve capacity and the petrodollar, they know that it's game over, and it's only a matter about how long time they can keep it running. And the next one to take over is China. It's obvious. And if the day comes that US or the NATO declares war to China, the only thing China has to do, according to my view on this, is actually just to say, we base our currency 10% on gold. And then everything will deflate. The euro, the yen, the dollars will be worthless. And how will you pay an American soldier who have a family home with worthless dollars? How good is that for morality? So they are now just hanging on to the American empire, but it's pulverized in, I will say, yeah, I don't know how many years, but in my lifetime, we will see it will be over, definitely. And I think this is just a warning signal somewhere, it could be a warning signal somewhere from the American to say to the Chinese, don't even think about it, because they also know that is the end game for the US empire. That's my opinion about it.
Okay, great. So, we have about 5 minutes left, and we have lots of people who want to ask questions, and I'm sure lots of amazing answers. So if everyone could think about being concise, even the people giving answers. and so I've got a short question. Just thinking, being new to all of this, what are your thoughts, anybody, on Bradley Manning, Snowden, Julian Assange, are they all infiltrators? Are they all, is that wrong? Is that just pop figures, or is that something that we, What is it?
I'm forcing Mark.
Yes.
Come on, Mark, you can do it.
I have to say something, don't I? This will be a concise answer. But I feel whenever any of these individuals get into the mainstream and they get talked about by the general public, there's a reason why they got there. Who was really surprised at the revelations of Edward Snowden about the fact that the NSA is spying on civilians? Was anyone in this room really surprised at these revelations? It wasn't really news to anyone that's been paying attention to what's going on. There are suspicious elements and anomalies and discrepancies with each of those three characters, I think. Maybe Bradley Manning, not so much, but Julian Assange, I think, has gone on record as saying he goes along with the official version of 9/11, if I'm not mistaken. And anyone that can make a statement like that, immediately, that's a red flag for me. So I just think there's a reason why these particular individuals' stories make it into the mainstream news, when there's a great many other whistleblowers and insiders with very pertinent information that don't make it. I just think we need to be suspicious of anything that is paraded in the mainstream media for us, because there's always an ulterior motive to it.
Right, thank you.
Hi, my name is Tonya. And I'd like to comment on this small discussion or kind of misunderstanding we're getting into. Quicksilver, the heavy stuff, I remember back in the physics class, holding quicksilver, and it was heavy. And I'm too nervous for this, I'm sorry. But
keep
the
on.
Thing is, I'm trying to say that misunderstandings, like the whole human family is misunderstood. And misunderstandings, they happen when there's a confusion between levels. we each have so much knowledge within us, within ourselves. And we have our areas where we know a lot more than others. We know many, many things, and we have so much experience with us. The arguments come, the misunderstandings come, is when we're trying to level different levels, and we have levels. I'm talking to you, Johan, about this, the high level and the lower, and, you know, and that's just what I want to say.
Okay, so no question?
I have a question for Lona. Would you say that it is ethical to eat mammals at all? Can we defend to eat mammals when they have feelings? Would it be better, like with fish, maybe if they're treated properly? They say water contain a lot of wisdom, so, and we do contain a lot of water, so we have a lot of wisdom within us. So if we can clear the water by projecting our minds to it, then get the circulation going and clean the water, and then maybe eat the fish instead of our mammals.
Okay, we have to, yeah.
Thank you. Well, I don't distinct between different kind of animals. I think that a fish is a living organism, just like a pig or a human for that matter. And I don't think it's a problem to eat animals. I don't do it myself, but I haven't any problems with the fact that animals are brought up for being eating. I think the issue is about how their lives is before they are eaten, and not the fact that we are doing it. The animals are eating other animals all the time, and the way our teeth and our organism is designed is just like the monkeys and the pigs. We can eat everything. So it's more a moral question about how we treat the animals while they are living and how we put them into death, I think.
Okay.
I just like to add that we are the only animal that has to fry other animals or to boil them before we can eat them.
Okay. So, actually, I'm terribly sorry, but we actually have to stop now because we have run over time. And there's a party. They turned down their music and they booked space as well, and they really want to have their party. So they're waiting. Yeah, go on, Frank.
I just have one thing which I would like to do to all our great speakers. I have a small present for you.
Oh wow!
Yeah, so it's like Christmas Eve. Huh? So Ole, thank you very much for coming. It has been a pleasure. Yeah. Yeah. And Johan, thank you very much for coming. Yeah.
Thank you.
And Lona, thank you very much for coming. Yeah. And Judith, thank you very much. It's been a pleasure. And Mark, thank you very much. Sorry, Ken, nothing for you. Thank you, man. Yeah. I got it. And to end all this, I think we should have all the people behind Open Mind Conference, Henrik and Morten and all the filming crew, Carol, Mass, everybody up here, and then we will make a line with the speeches. And we will have some light here. Is anybody turning the light on? Then we can have some good pictures. Okay?
Yay! Let's bring all the open mic people.
Please remember people up and stay to help.
Yeah. Okay, maybe we should just be sitting here. Yeah. Thank you for coming, all of you great people. Yeah. Everybody got a photo? Should we raise up and... Yeah, you want to. Come on, we are two big men. Yeah. Come on, line up.
Spread the word, spread the word.
Yeah. Hey, Michael, we need you up here. It's because he's from the southern part of Jutland, and they don't want to make too much mess. Every time they did it, the Germans came and kicked their asses. Michael, he's a very important person. Without Michael, we wouldn't have this beautiful scene and decoration. So give Michael a big, big hand.
Born from Sweden, born from Sweden, music on.
Yes, and Janåke, come on. Without you, we didn't wear so relaxed.
Yeah.
Yeah. And again, I want to thank for, I think I can say everybody up here, thank you for coming. Keep on supporting us, support the Full Circle project, and you know, spread the word and tell everybody. It's much better to watch all this sometimes very dark subjects together with other open-minded people on the same frequency than sitting at home at YouTube and just bury a big hole. So I hope next year we will be even more people. So hope to see you all again. Thank you for coming.
We also want to say thank you to all the volunteers.
Yeah.
Some volunteers around. Thank you to them. The heart. It's all about the heart, isn't it?